Continuing our survey of weird literature, we advance east to the Indian subcontinent and Rudyard Kipling's strange ride of Morrowbie Jukes. In his landmark essay on supernatural horror in literature, HP Lovecraft opens his section on the British Isles by describing its contribution to the weird as gratifyingly fertile. He continues, "Rudyard Kipling has often approached it, and has, despite the omnipresent mannerisms, handled it with indubitable mastery. Our next tale has much to live up to." The storyteller begins with a proverb that frames the tale with a macabre and ghoulish tone. "Alive or dead, there is no other way." I'm not convinced this is an actual proverb, and perhaps this is our first clue that not everything is as it seems. It starts with an overly earnest plea that everything related is true, and that the teller has recalled the story several times in these exact words. The narrator reinforces this idea by saying that the tale is of such a distressing nature that he will not reveal where the real place is. Already we're on guard from a trope that we have already seen several times. We're given a vague description of a location in the northwest of India, now part of Pakistan, somewhere in the Great Desert. The protagonist of the adventure is an English civil engineer with the name Morrowbie Jukes, a strange character who demonstrates some grisly behaviour. He has a fever and complains about the barking of dogs outside. After having one killed, he relates that it was eaten by the other dogs. The barking continues to upset him, and he decides to take a spear out on his horse to teach them a lesson. This seems extreme, to say the least. He foolishly races his horse into the night in pursuit. After baying at the moon, surely another significant metaphor, the horse bolts and together they fall into a sandy ravine on the edge of a river. Jukes wakes up the next morning to find himself in a village of the living dead, trapped in by the steep soft sand of the desert above and the river to the side. The strange inhabitants of this place are people who have had some disease and, having been thought dead, placed on a funeral pyre, but only to revive and confound expectations. Perhaps because of fear or superstition, this is never really explained. They are then imprisoned in this place. Jukes attempts to escape, but each time fails, finding it impossible to climb out because of the sandy slope, and unable to cross the river, which is patrolled by a rifleman in a boat. He then recognises a man there, an ex-Brahmin named Gunga Das. It is a strained relationship, but advantageous to Jukes, as much as he receives food from him in the form of dead crows to eat. Eventually, Jukes discovers that another Englishman had been there and died. On his corpse, Jukes finds a note. Kipling's tale tends to a poish sense of the macabre and gothic, weaved within the landscape and language of India, somewhere he served as a civil engineer for a number of years. But the weird here is not based in exoticism, but the marooning of the protagonist in an underworld of half-dead revenants. Kipling plays with several strong themes of man, madness and animals. The bolting horse, the mad dogs, the crows. The horse sees a grisly fate in the story too, in a way that would repulse English sensibilities, in a way that the slaying of man's best friend would too. The phrase to eat crow also serves as an insight, especially given that the crow is an unlikely desert creature. It's also worth noting that the crow carries a lot of symbolism in the Hindu faith, having connections to both dead ancestors and the underworld, and the idea of eating crows would certainly be a taboo. We're constantly being challenged by what to believe in the story. To return to the proverb that begins the story, any student of weird fiction knows that there are many things that dwell within the spaces in between. In fact, it is with this opening salvo that Kipling nails the very quintessence of the weird, the phenomena that dares to confound our categorisations. Madness and absurdity are weaved throughout the story, from the baying at the moon, on horseback, the cannibal dogs, the bizarre setting that makes less sense the more it is interrogated, the holy man turned murderous villain. The whole story seems more like the fever dream that is described at the start, rather than anything that could be trusted. I hope these words encourage you to read the story, as it's an important example of what would become the modern weird tale. And I hope you will join me again as I continue my strange surveys of weird literature.